All right, it's time for another episode of Stupidity in the Gamosphere. So, there's two topics this time. One that's focused primarily on Mighty No. 9, and then another one that's Dragon Age. Apparently, BioWare might be making another Dragon Age game. These will also be topics on this weekend's BS Busters. So, remember, Sunday, July 30th, we'll be doing BS Busters, 7 to 8:30. I'll be joined by Triple M, probably Kenoshi Abamayo, definitely, Yin Yang Yao, so, or AKA Jewel Red or Moonstar. So, without much ado, let's get to it. So Mighty No. 9's physical editions finally ship, and they're disappointing too. Basically, I'm not going to read this entire article, but I'll leave a link in the description, but basically, the people who paid $60 for a physical edition of this game, they were supposed to get a colored manual, and they didn't. They got a black and white manual, a grayscale, and the manual doesn't even fit the damn box. So, you can tell this was just some half-ass shit thrown together. Essentially, I mean, I'll give my thoughts after the cut, but I mean, you know. So, our next story is essentially what various people on PC Gamer who played Dragon Age 2, Dragon Age 1, Dragon Age Origins, Dragon Age Inquisition want from the next one, from a new Dragon Age. They want better combat, less extraneous side quests, open world areas that don't feel like MMO zones, complicated villains, dragons, new game plus, big parties and lots of banter, campaigns that disagree, no more deep roads, a good dog. Their explanations are a little bit less nuanced. The overall thing that I've pretty much gotten from reading this article is that they want the things that made Origins better than every other game in the series in terms of core gameplay, but they don't want it to be Origins. Because everything in here that the guy's praising, that these people are praising, was pretty much heavily factored into Origins and hasn't been in any of the other games. And yet, Dragon Age 2 is the best one. We'll be talking about this during this Sunday's BS Busters at 7 o'clock to 8:30 Eastern Standard Time, 7 o'clock p.m. to 8:30 p.m. We might go longer because, look, sometimes we go off the rails. So with that being said, peace out, enjoy. Okay, here we are at the breakdown, and I guess we'll start with Mighty No. 9 first. Now, let me do a disclaimer. I did not kickstart Mighty No. 9. I didn't give any money to KK Nifuni or Concept. I did buy the game, and it's not terrible. It could be a lot better, but it's not a steaming pile of shit. With that being said, the game is, how can I put this in a nice way? Mighty No. 9 has a lot of potential, but it just did not really pan out the way it should have. And I'm not sure why. But with that being said, it's not a terrible game. So, but I mean, the merits of the game itself are secondary to the game might not be terrible, but my God, did they fuck up the rollout of the title. So with that being said, let's talk about the elephant in the room, which is concept fucked up. Concept totally fucked up, putting this game out there. And it's sad because it's a good game. It is legitimately a good game. It's not great. It's not perfect. You know, if you were going into Mighty No. 9 thinking this is going to be the next Mega Man, the next whatever, you're not going to get it. But if you're going into it thinking this is going to be a standard platformer in the vein of a Mega Man or Mega Man X, you're going to get it. The art style was nice, but I mean, Keiji Inafune fucked up. And how he fucked up? Well, it's pretty damn simple, really. See, Keiji Inafune got the big head. What I mean by having the big head, I mean he literally just kind of, he fucked up, all right? He fucked up. And when I say he fucked up, I mean, like, here's the thing, okay? This is anecdotal evidence, but I mean, observation is the cornerstone of all knowledge, okay? If you look at every single Japanese developer who's left their development house, they have not turned out well, okay? Most of them, okay? Most of them have not turned out well. I have to say, the only real kind of exception to that particular rule is maybe I don't know, maybe Shinji Mikami and the folks over at Platinum, they're the only ones who I can say have legitimately, who have legitimately kind of left their old company and are still making games and the games that they like to make. Not just some jury-rigged shit that's just kind of thrown out over and over again. That's the only real kind of exception to the rule I can think of. The rest of them are just, I mean, they don't do well. And the reason I think they don't do well is because a lot of these developers forget that the reason they're able to do what they do is because they have, like, all these resources from, you know, these publishers, you know, they have all these damn resources. And they forget that. They forget that they have all these damn resources. And then they go and they fucking they leave the studio or the publisher that they used to work with, and they still have this I have these all these massive resources attitude when they don't. It's like, dude, you do not have, you know, huge amounts of resources like you used to. You're kind of fucked, really, dude. And they don't understand that. They don't get it. So I think that Keiji Inafune still has this I have the massive resources of Capcom behind me. Which, here's the thing. I know Capcom has kind of been lowballing, but they are a huge publisher in Japan. They still do have a lot of resources, okay? And I mean, when you have those types of resources, you can afford to take a little bit more risk with certain things by budgeting correctly than you can if you're some huge, whoever. We'll move on to Dragon Age after the cut. All right. I guess it's time to talk about Dragon Age, another Dragon Age game. So I'm going to give you a general overview of what each of these bullet points are, and then I'll give you my rebuttal. The first one, better combat. Basically, the guy says that he doesn't want to reprise Origins combat because that's not how big publishers make RPGs now, for better or worse. But he does want the level of strategic callback that they had back in those days on a, in a more modern aesthetic. I can agree with that. Less extraneous side quests. I would have to say that the side quests in Dragon Age have gotten progressively worse with each iteration. Dragon Age 1 had okay side quests. Dragon Age Origins had good side quests. Dragon Age 2 had bordering on like make work side quests. And then Dragon Age Inquisition had side quests that were just busy work. It's like, I need you to find 20 herbs. I need you to find 20 iron deposits. I need you to find 15 anthracite deposits. It was, no. I mean, I don't mind doing side quests if it makes sense. I don't know. If they were to do like a good example of a side quest of a collection side of a co side quest that has a collection aspect that makes sense is, let's say during the course of the game you come across a looted caravan and you basically you see wounded members of the caravan who are like dying by the side of the road. You heal them, you help them out. But the master of the caravan says his life savings has been stolen by some bandits, right? And you begin to chase down these bandits, and it turns out to be a much bigger side quest than you might think because these bandits have turned on each other and split apart, and you have to go after each of these little split off splinters of this bandit group that raided this caravan. And meanwhile, telling a meaningful story that turns out that the merchant you helped is not so innocent, and the bandits aren't so bad themselves. That's a good idea for a good side quest that has you, fighting groups of enemies, chasing enemies down, but done well. The next thing the guy says is open world areas that don't feel like MMO zones. I have to agree with that. I think Dragon Age Origins was at its best when it wasn't just a series of open areas where a lot of stupid shit to do. I think it was at its best when it had crafted set pieces with a few areas that were kind of open, like when you went to the main city in Ferelden, the capital city. That was interesting, or Orzammar or something like that. Complicated villains. I mean, I don't really think he uses as an example like, as complicated villains Taren Loghain, Flemeth, and the Qunari Aroshock. That was from Dragon Age 2. I don't really think that was the problem with Dragon Age 2. The problem with Dragon Age 2 was that it was lazy. The game was lazy, very, very, very fucking lazy. The enemies were lazy. The dungeons were lazy. The character progression system was lazy. The scenario writing was lazy. It was just a very lazy game, a cash-in, really. I don't necessarily think Taren Loghain was a particularly complicated villain. He was a traitor who betrayed his king because he couldn't see that in order for and this is getting a little nerdy because if you played the original Dragon Age Origins, you would know this. Basically, the king had basically figured out that King Kylan, I remember his name was, he'd basically figured out that he'd come to the conclusion that the only way they could defeat the or at least hold back the darkspawn in their, thing going on was essentially by combining forces with Orlais that had invaded Ferelden, 30, 40 years earlier. And Taren Logan's like, we're not gonna do that. And he basically refused, even though the Grey Wardens had basically lit the signal to send the second army in to wipe up the Darkspawn, he didn't do it. And basically, Loghain is one of the principal causes for all the fucked up shit that happens in Dragon Age Origins because he thought he knew better than the king because the king was young and all that shit. But it was a good idea. You're dealing with a world-ending threat. Why are you worried about national interests when we have a world-ending fucking threat? Yeah. Flemeth wasn't really a villain, although you can kill her in Dragon Age Origins for Morrigan. And the Qunari Aurif Shark in Dragon Age 2. The Qunari Aurif Shark in Dragon Age 2 is, once again, lazy as fuck. There's no motivation for him to even try and attack you. Dragon Age 2 should be stricken from the record. So, this guy is basically saying that, these are complicated villains. Not really, but they do have their own motivations. I will say that. That beyond just, I want to destroy these people. Dragons. I can agree. The dragons in Dragon Age Inquisition are the only time that you actually have to strategize and use abilities. Other than that, it's basically just especially on higher difficulties. On lower difficulties, you just level up and have good equipment and you're fine. It's just lazy. It's fucking lazy. New Game Plus. Yeah, they definitely do need a New Game Plus in Dragon Age. I think every RPG should have New Game Pluses, because you collected all this shit, you beat the game, you should be able to start the game all over again with most of your equipment except for story critical stuff, like the ultimate sword you found, in a dragon's cavern. Okay, obviously you won't have that weapon, but other shit you should be able to have. And I should be able to keep my level and just start all over again. I don't know why New Game Plus is so fucking difficult for so many developers with RPGs. Big parties and lots of banter. Dragon Age Origins had, in my opinion, the best party inter-party banter. Dragon Age 2's was shitty. Dragon Age Inquisition's was also shitty. It was like Dragon Age 2, you just didn't have a big enough party. And Dragon Age 3, basically, aka Inquisition, was just, it felt too forced. Companions that disagree. Yeah, I mean, this has been a big component of Dragon Age for a while, but I think if your character has a high enough charisma or your relationship with those characters is close enough, you should be able to at least talk them down from leaving your side. They might not be as invested in your interests, but because they're your friend, they'll help you out. here's where we're going to part ways with Tom Senior here. No more deep roads. Okay, first of all, the deep roads were important to the story. It was really fucking important. Just because this guy played a rogue who couldn't backstab the brood mother, the Deep Roads was important. It basically was this claustrophobic, tense moment because basically the deeper you got in the Deep Roads, the tougher the enemies got, and the creepier shit got to the point where you're like, shit, something bad's about to go down. And you find out one of the horrible secrets about the Darkspawn. The Darkspawn don't come from dragons. Oh no, 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 no. AKA the Archdemon. The Archdemon is just basically a corrupted, a tainted dragon. No, 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 no. The Darkspawn come from brood mothers. And brood mothers, oh boy, brood mothers are something else. Brood mothers are what you get when you essentially, in Dragon Age Origins, you find out that, like, when dwarves are brought into the dwarven females and human females and elven females get kidnapped by the Darkspawn whenever they have these blights come. The reason the women get kidnapped is because in order for there to be more Darkspawn, they need women. What they do is that they take these women and hold them captive and feed them tainted meat. When I say tainted, I mean the meat, the flesh of either dead Darkspawn or people who have been tainted by the blight and died instead of, you know, surviving. They feed off the people, and what you get is a damn, well, for lack of a better word, you get the women's bodies begin to change. Some women aren't strong enough and they die. Those that don't, and those are the lucky ones, those that don't become brood mothers. Brood mothers give birth to Darkspawn. Genlocks, which are dwarven Darkspawn, Herlocks, human Darkspawns, Shrieks, which are elven Darkspawn, and ogres, those big motherfuckers who are Kunari Darkspawn. Now, broodmothers are fucking hideous. One of the most terrifying bosses I have ever seen in any game, and still one of the most fucked up bosses I've ever seen in a game. And I would say to anybody, oh shit, I never want to fight a broodmother ever again. And his final thing is that he wants a good dog. They only had the dog in Origins. I don't know why they didn't have the dog in any other game, but they need to bring it back. Enough said. So there you go. Those are my thoughts. I would like to hear how you feel. And I'll tell you what's coming up after the cut, upcoming events after the cut. Peace. Okay, so upcoming events, very simple. This Sunday we'll be doing BS Busters, going back to our original format. And there's some bullshit that's come up this week that definitely needs to be talked about. Capcom figures, Keiji Inafune figures into it. And BioWare figures into it, so it's going to be a trifecta, if you will, of bullshit that's going to get busted. So, that being said, enjoy the rest of the video. Actually, don't enjoy the rest of the video because I'm going to end it after I finish with this, and we'll move on to the next bit of information, and enjoy it.